Well, I've come out today to the Lake District, met up with Steve, and we're out here now near Yew Tree Tarn, and I've got a few ideas. Now, I don't normally do these sorts of videos with me out in the field, but there's a few things that I want to shoot today, and I'm going to try and process them back at the office. If it all works out, I'll show you how I do it. The observant amongst you will realise that this is no longer the forest that I was in before, and in fact, it's about 6-7 hours further on in the day. This is the first composition I'm going to try. It's actually looking down towards Coniston, and we've got the rock in the foreground with the heather, and what I want to try and do is emphasize the rock. So I've got the camera orientated into the portrait orientation rather than landscape, and I've got a wide angle lens on there, probably about 11 millimeters at the moment, and the f-stop I've got down at f13 just to try and capture enough depth of field. Now, if it works, what I'm going to do is try to enlarge the foreground using the warp tools in Photoshop. I hope you enjoyed the introduction and that it's helped explain how I captured the shot. I've now imported the image into Capture One, and I'll quickly explain my editing before we actually look at making the perspective adjustments. If you don't use Capture One, it's still worth watching this section of the video to understand my RAW editing. Most RAW converters have similar features as Capture One. Here's the starting position for the RAW files before I've made any corrections. I'll then turn off the distortion correction, which may seem a little bit odd. The reasons I've done this, though, are to minimise any image stretching into the corners of the frame. We'll be doing plenty of that in Photoshop, but if we distort the image too much now, it will soften the results later. To adjust the image colours, I've switched from the Fuji Provia film curve to use the film standard curve. This is a generic profile that ships with Capture One, and it usually works very well with landscape photography. I'll also increase the colour temperature of the image to bring back the warmth. When I took the shot, I had the camera set to auto white balance, and I have to say it's done an absolutely brilliant job of neutralising the warm light which you saw in the video, so I needed to add the warmth back. The only other adjustments that I've made to the background layer were to the detail. I've removed the noise reduction, which isn't needed with this shot, and I increased the sharpening slightly to make sure that I'm starting with a very sharp image. After making those adjustments to the background layer, I've then made further changes on separate layers. I've used the first of these to selectively open the shadows, which were a bit dark and contrasty in the original. I've done this by adding a filled adjustment layer and applying my adjustments to that. I've then cleared the mask on the layer, which hides the adjustments so that I can selectively paint them in with the brush tool. It's a technique that I use a lot, and I've explained it fully in another video. If you've never used it before, I'll include a link to that video in the YouTube video information for this one. I then use the same technique to reduce the brightness of the sky and the distant landscape. The next problem I have is that I wanted the heather to be in flower. Unfortunately, we were a few weeks too late for that, and whilst there are some flowers, most of them are dead. My fix is to selectively adjust the hue of the dead flowers to turn them purple using the Advanced Color Editor. This is another tool that I've covered in a separate video, and I'll also include a link to that in this video information. Finally, to improve the colour harmony in the image, I've added another layer to emphasise the warm light on the grass. That's also done using the Advanced Colour Editing tool. As I said, you can make very similar adjustments to these with most RAW editors. Now it's time to export the image to Photoshop, where the fun begins. The first thing that I want to tackle is the tripod leg that you can see in the corner of the frame. That should give you some idea of just how wide a focal length I was using to capture this image. Rather than trying to fix the problem with the clone and healing tools, I'm going to use Photoshop's content aware fill. It's a good option to make quick repairs to large areas of an image. I'll start by adding a new empty layer for the repair. I'll then use the lasso tool to draw a rough selection around the tripod leg. When I'm doing this, I'm trying to avoid including any of the heather on the left because I think it will make a better repair that way. Once I've made my selection, I can use the Content Aware Fill command in the Edit menu. The dialog shows me what's happening, and I can use it to check the quality of the results. It looks reasonable to me, so I'll make the repair. The repair is then on a separate layer to the original image, making it easy to start again if it hasn't worked well. Looking more closely, I can see there are still some edges in the repair that I want to tidy up. I can do this using the clone brush tool with a soft edge. I'm not spending a lot of time on the repair at this stage because we will probably lose a lot of this area in the finished image. Now, one of the problems that you encounter using an extreme wide angle lens is that it distorts perspective. If you look back to when I shot this, I had the camera 2 or 3 feet from the rock in the foreground. With a 10mm focal length, that's probably too far, and it makes the foreground rock appear too small in the frame. One solution would have been to shoot a couple of frames using different focal lengths and positions before blending them. The alternative that I'm going to use is to distort the foreground using the Photoshop Transform tools. I'll start by duplicating the adjustments I've made to a new layer to work with. Using the lasso tool, I'll draw a selection of the foreground filling roughly 70% of the frame. As I'm doing this, I'm trying to go around more obvious features like the clumps of the heather. This will make it easier to blend the results seamlessly with the rest of the image. I should also mention that I have the lasso tool set to the add selection using this icon in the toolbar. This allows me to select small sections of the image at a time. Each new selection is then added to the existing selection. After selecting the foreground, I can use the Edit menu to choose Transform and then Perspective. I can then use the drag handles in the corner to adjust the perspective of the selection. When I drag out from the bottom corner, it makes the foreground look larger in the frame. I'm happy with that change, so I'll accept it and clear the selection. The adjustment looks good at this stage, but I can see an edge along the top where I drew the selection. The fix for this is to add an empty mask to the layer. I can then use the brush tool set at about 50% opacity with a soft edge to paint black onto the mask. This blends the two areas of the image to hide the join. I now have a seamless blend that's difficult to detect, but I've also flattened some of the clumps of heather when I change the perspective. The way that I'll fix it is using the liquify filter. As before, I'll create a new stamp layer to work with. This time I'll convert it to a smart object before I apply the liquify filter. Then when I save my changes in the liquify filter, they're available in the future, even if I've closed and reopened the image. Unfortunately, the transform adjustments I made earlier don't work with smart objects, or I'd have used this technique there as well. Now I can apply the liquify filter in the filter menu. The liquify filter dialog has several different tools I can use to distort the image. I'm going to use the bloat tool first to expand the clumps of heather. All I need to do is size the brush using the bracket keys on my keyboard. I can then paint over the heather to make my adjustments. I can also use a very large brush to expand the foreground at the corners of the image. The other tweak I want to make is using the forward warp tool. I'm going to use this to push up the hills on the right side of the frame. This helps to create a better balance between the two sides of the frame. When I'm satisfied, I can click OK and apply the changes. The image now looks the way that I want it to. Let's check the corners at 100% magnification. I can see some softness there now, where I've been distorting the image quite a lot. The way I'll fix that is using Topaz Sharpen AI. As before, I'll create a new stamp layer to work on. I'll then launch Topaz Sharpener AI. Now I won't take you through all the different sharpening options. If you want to know about these, I have another video explaining, and I'll include the link in the YouTube video information. After sharpening the image with Sharpen AI, you can see that it's fixed the softness. Let's compare the results now with the starting image. As you can see, the perspective changes have emphasised the foreground, making it look quite a different image. This isn't something I do a lot, but it's a useful technique to have in your editing bag of tricks. I hope that you've enjoyed today's video. Please let me know in the comments if you like the intro showing the location and how I took the shot. It will be helpful to know what you think. And don't forget to click the share button to share the video. I'm Robin Whalley, you've been watching Lenscraft. I'll see you soon for another video. ¶¶